Turn with me, if you would, to the book of Romans, chapter 12, where the Lord has led me. Amen. Where the Lord has led me. And we're talking about stewardship, but I'm going to talk about the attitude, what it takes. You got to have the right attitude to be a good steward.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. It starts with the mind.
Taking
care
of it.
His business.
Yes.
Amen. So you can do it in such a great way, in a positive way. Romans chapter 12. Let's pick up at verse 14. And I'll read briefly these passages of scripture. Romans 12, y'all there?
Yeah.
Verse 14. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse.
Uh-oh.
Rejoice with those who rejoice, and weep with those who weep. Be of the same mind toward one another. Do not set your mind on high things,
yeah,
but associate with the humble.
Mm-hmm.
Do not be wise in your own opinion.
That's it.
Praise God. Let the Lord bless his word. Going to talk to you from this subject, having a gracious attitude.
All right. Amen.
Turn to your nearest neighbor.
Amen.
Pastor's going to preach about
it.
Having a gracious attitude.
Having a gracious attitude.
You may be seated.
That's it.
Having a gracious attitude. God bless you, ushers. Thank you for standing on your post. The word attitude, you all, has its origin in the word aptitude. It speaks of natural ability. It is a mental position, and with regards to the fact, to a fact, or if you will, a situation,
mm-hmm,
is a feeling or emotion toward a fact or a situation. Attitude has reference to the state of readiness to respond in a characteristic way to a stimulus.
Right.
What you saying, preacher? Attitude defined, you all, as a state of mind or a feeling.
Yeah.
Better still, Brother Bell, it's a disposition.
All right.
Attitude, you all, is the way a person views something or tends to behave towards it. Talking about attitude. Paul reminds us that we must enter into the feelings of others. Somebody seated here today, this present moment, came into the house of worship in a state of readiness in your mind. And it prompts you all to have an attitude. One or two folks, you all, in your row, went to bed last night with an unholy disposition. That is, it had stimulated your mind to form negative thoughts about someone or somebody. I'm just trying to paint the picture about having an attitude. At least three persons this morning go to their jobs day after day with an attitude. In these verses, you all, the text, I want us to spend a few moments looking at the proper attitude Christians should have when relate and deal with others. Is that all right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, in this passage of Scripture, these particular passages of Scripture, Paul was looking at the attitude of Christians as they deal with both sinners and saints. Christian fellowship, you all, is more than a part of a pat on the back or just a handshake. Christian fellowship is sharing the burdens and the blessings of others so that we all grow together and glorify God. You see, a humble attitude and a willingness to share are the marks of a Christian who truly ministers you all to the body. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ ministered to common people, and they heard him gladly. Mark 12:37. He ministered and they heard him gladly.
Yeah, yeah.
When a local church decides it wants only a certain high class of people, it departs from the Christian ideal of ministry.
Right.
And we'll discuss today a few moments, you all, of the text, and we'll look at some movements in our text today. First of all, bless those who persecute you. It's right here in the text, verse 14. Bless those who persecute you. There is one thing that is not easy to do. Y'all agree with that?
All right.
It requires us to act completely opposite of human nature.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
This word bless, Brother Haywood, means to celebrate with praises, to ask God the blessings of favor. In other words, to speak well of. This verse teaches us that Christians, we're required of God to do more than just than resist hating those who persecute us. We're required of God to do more than resist retaliation against those who persecute us. We are to bless them.
Yes.
That's where the rubber hits the road. And we are to speak well of them and ask God's favor of them when they say some bad things about you. Or have something done something wrong about you. Say amen if you can.
Amen.
This word persecute means to pursue in a hostile manner.
Yeah.
It means to harass, to trouble, or even molest.
Right.
We're talking about persecution. Right. In other words, it means to mistreat folk. When we are mistreated by others, the apostle, you all, is teaching us here that we are to speak well of those who mistreat us.
Have mercy.
Let me get two people to say amen.
Amen.
Have mercy.
And not curse them. Not talk bad about them. Not want to slice their ties. Not want to egg their car. Amen. Not want to do something, amen, to their house. Not send them a bad note. You don't want to bring evil upon them. You don't want to have them bad thoughts about them. Y'all can say amen.
Amen.
Jesus even taught his disciples in the Sermon on the Mount to love their enemies. Now you just ain't gonna wake up and start loving your enemies.
That's right,
man. Larry did a great job today when you talked about Sunday school. Amen. You know, it takes growth. This is where you grow. You got to be in Sunday school. You got to study the 23rd Psalms. You got to develop a relationship with God.
Yes, sir.
You got to love God.
Stay right there.
So you can love your fellow man.
Yeah.
Who you see every day.
Oh, yeah.
But you say you love Jesus.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
But you can't love that person that you see every day.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, both Jesus and Paul would have us to know that there is no real credit to a Christian who only loves those who are lovable and love.
Yeah.
You ain't doing nothing.
Yeah.
That loving folk that liking folk that like you.
That's right, man.
And loving folk that love you. You ain't doing nothing.
You ain't
you're not
doing
stretching
that.
Far. Amen. The way you need to be as a Christian. See, a sinner can love like that, but it takes a strong Christian. Say strong Christian. To love a person as if that person is your friend when you know that person is persecuting you.
Yeah.
I know as a man, it's hard to shake somebody's man's hand. I know this brother is talking about.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen.
Right.
Amen, somebody. But you got to love them and smile and say, God bless you, amen. And you might be a time you have to hug them and you hug them and you just throw in your eyes and just want them back up. You really don't like that person. Hey, I'm in your house. Paul's challenge to his readers was to them to not maintain an attitude of resentment and hostility toward those who persecuted them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is the teaching, you all. This is the teaching, what he's saying. Resentment and hostility toward others are two things that will ruin you both spiritually, you all, and emotionally.
Yeah.
Second point is right there in verse 15. Share the joys and burdens of others.
Yeah.
Now that's growth, you all. That's maturity.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's maturity.
Yeah.
Here Paul was calling upon his readers to show a genuine interest in others. As I had to pause and let that soak up. As Brother Crosby, rejoice means to be glad, to have a recurring joy. Rejoice. Human nature often resents others doing well when we're not doing so well. Amen. Human nature often feels disappointed and indifferent when others experience success. Human nature, you working hard, amen, and you on your yard, the man across the street ain't doing nothing. He got a beautiful yard.
Now, preach it down.
Amen. Right, you just sent folks and kids to college. You gave money and all of that. You trying to struggle to keep your car running, and they get new cars every 2 years, amen. You don't know what they doing, amen, over there. Human nature often resents others doing well when you're not doing so well. So Paul was calling upon his readers to live above human nature and live according to the Spirit. Hang on, I'm going somewhere. Galatians 5:25 tells us, brethren, if you live in the Spirit, you should also walk in the Spirit. If you're a Christian, if you're living in the Spirit, you ought to walk in it. Solomon once said, I don't want to scare you, I don't want to frighten you, Proverbs. Solomon said in Proverbs 17:5 that those who rejoice in the calamities of the others will be punished. Church, your neighbor said, neighbor, God's watching you.
God's watching you.
It's in your Bible. Quit wishing bad stuff on folks.
That's right, man. That's right.
God's watching
that's
you.
The truth, man. That's the truth, man.
The calamities of others.
That's right.
See, we won't. Yeah. Jesus even, God even, Paul even said, he said, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. He said, I will repay. See, we want to watch folks suffer so we can get to glory and be satisfied. Let God deal with his people. We want to stand around and watch them. God might not deal with them at that moment. He might deal with them next month. Y'all listen to me, next year. 4 years down the road. That's why we don't worry about Washington. Don't worry about Donald Trump. The Lord gonna deal with that man and everybody else.
Yes, God.
You see, you want it to happen in your lifetime. You want to see it before these 100 days is over with. Hey, we might not get to these 100 days. Just keep watching. He might do it on 101 day. Now listen to me. The attitude of a Christian is to be that of rejoicing when we see others prospering, despite you all our own personal circumstances. Paul told the Corinthians that if one member of the body is honored, then all the members of the body are also to be honored. Mm-hmm. And I say that you all listen here, that when something happens, it's one of y'all good and great in church, amen, get promoted, get there, get that, and I'm going to be excited.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's how we should be. You all. Now, if one member of the body suffers, though, all the members of the body suffer also. I say all the time, you all. If one of y'all hurt, you all, I'm hurt. Amen. One of y'all sick. I was thinking about that today. You all. I can go ahead and say it. Amen. It was a beautiful thing, you all. It was a beautiful thing to hear Lauren and Buddy
sing
it. A few months ago, so Watson couldn't do something up like that.
Amen.
A few months ago, can I preach it like a fellow? Brother Brad couldn't walk up in here. She had her mic, he had his mic. And they blessed her out. And I said, I want my class. I said, thank you, Jesus. I feel the same. Thank you, Lord. And God, you broke him up. And you ain't down with him yet. Sister Watson, and I had to get on Brother Black because he eating the wrong stuff in the hospital. I'm going to spend my check, and I'm still going to stay with it.
Hey.
He's older than me, but I'm bigger than him, Sister. I give him a whip. We ought to be happy.
Yes, sir.
Right. One of them platted up.
Point is, as Christians, we need to know how to be sensitive to disappointments. Sensitive, you are, to sufferings. Sensitive to the sorrows of others. Sensitive. We're to show sympathy, you all, and compassion to others. We call ourselves Reverend Bradley Christians. We love the Lord with all our heart, soul, and mind. Do you really?
Yeah.
This is a challenge for us to hear. We be near to others. You ought to feel what they feel. Are we going deeper? Look what it said. It said to weep. Weep, you all. It said, bless those, rejoice with those. And verse 15, weep with those who weep. A lot of us let folks just cry by themselves.
Mm. Mm. Mm-hmm.
I done cried enough. I don't need to cry. But the text says love means to mourn.
Yeah.
To grieve or to be in sorrow.
Yes, sir.
It means to cry or be in pain.
Yeah.
And showing compassion for others. You all are weeping with those who weep. That means we help with them whenever we can.
Yeah.
You got to help with them whenever you can.
Yeah.
And it ain't always about money.
Yeah.
It could be a car.
That's right.
Could be a plate of food.
Right.
Could be a breakfast.
Right.
Could be a gift certificate.
Right.
Could be a bus token.
Mm-hmm.
Means to help whenever you can.
Yeah.
Do you need something? Because
yeah.
You know what?
Yeah.
You keep on living.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Your time's going to be coming.
It's coming. It's coming.
I said earlier, you miss one or two car payments, they gonna
get
it. You get laid up, they gonna come pick up your car. Amen. Because we got a member of the BPU board here. He can't keep your lights on. You miss playing BPU. Amen. Clicker. You gonna be in the dark. You gonna need some flashlights. You gonna need some candle. Do I have a witness up here? Terry, he works for the gas company.
Mm-hmm.
He can't help you.
Yeah.
You don't pay your bill.
Thank you.
You gonna have on blankets, coats, caps, scarves. You will be covered in your house. I said barbecue and outside. Amen.
That's it.
You gotta help whenever you can.
You might have to go through. Yeah.
Third, and let me get out of here. Verse 16. Tell us, verse 16. But be of the same mind toward one another. Look at this. These words challenge us to get inside the minds of the others and strive to understand them.
Right.
Now that ain't that deep as it sounds. Watch that. Watch this. It is a challenge to understand others so well that we identify and feel with them. Let me help you. The words "the same mind" means to be agreed together or to cherish the same view. Paul was speaking, you all, of being harmonious. Here Paul was challenging his readers not to show partiality in their relationship with one another. It gets a little deeper. We need to know that when we stand before God, that the ground is the level. That the ground is a level. God loves all people and he expects to love those whom he loves. James would have us to know, you all, that showing partiality is not of God. You need some help? When we are to show partiality, we break God's law of love. James chapter 2, verse 9 through 11. Love for others, you all, is at the core of God's law. And you break one law, you all, you're going to break them all. Because God's law demands equality toward people. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, stop breaking the law.
Stop breaking the law.
Stop breaking the law. And fourthly, a right estimate of self. That's what we say. It tells us, so not let your mind be on high things, but associate with the humble. Do not be wise in your opinion. Here we go, here we go. I'm going to come down your road right now real good. If we are to have a right relationship with others, we must properly evaluate ourselves in the words "haughty in mind." Paul had a reference to minding high, exalted, or lofty things. Watch the text. The words mean that Paul was telling his readers not to think of things of preeminence, prestige, and honor. Don't think more highly of yourself than you ought to think. Y'all didn't miss it. Don't think more highly of yourself than you ought to think. Don't think more highly of yourself. Let me hit it again. That you ought to think. You ain't all of that in a bag of chips. One day you wasn't dressing like you was dressing. One day you wasn't living like you living. One day you were driving what you were driving, but in the blink of an eye, it can all leave. But since you got a degree, Since you got a couple of cars, since you got two or three pairs of shoes, since you got ladies two or three different type hairdo, one time you were struggling for one. So don't think that you all of that, because one time you had one, amen, one pair of shoes. I told y'all 2 weeks ago, amen. One time, amen, at one time in my life, I had two suits, and one of them was too little, amen. So it ain't no, I can't get excited if I see a brother with no suit. But thanks to Sister Marilyn, I got 3 or 4 or 5 now. But you got to look at this thing holistic. Don't think you all there, because you can go right back. If you look back, if you look back over your life and you think things over, you can truly say, hey, I got a testimony. Right. We got it all together. Let me get out of here. God does not want us to be an upper crust or elite, an exclusive church. Yeah, an upper crust church. God is, Brother Moore, God does not want there to be a group of self-serving people around who everything must revolve around. Strife for vain glory, not greater faith, but some churches, if it don't come through me, it ain't gonna happen. We all up here.
Yes, sir.
And everybody else is down here.
That's it, man.
This is your church.
Yeah.
We all on the same level.
Yes, sir.
This is God's church.
That's it.
Because you know what? We had Senior Saints Day a few weeks ago.
Tell it, man.
19 folks, I eulogize.
That's it.
Stood over there and prayed and tried to preach and say some encouraging words. They gone.
Yes, sir. Yes,
but
sir.
The church is still here.
Yeah.
The church is still here. These ain't the same deacons.
That's right.
But the church is still here.
Yeah.
These ain't
That's
the
it.
Same associates.
That's
some of y'all remember we didn't have no associates. But the church is still here. These ain't the same ushers. Preach, Reverend Marley, but they still here. This ain't the same artists we started with.
Right.
But the church is still here. One time Jody wasn't here, but the church is still here. One time then nobody said, preach, Reverend Marley, at this organ. And it just collected dust. And we bought it for somebody that got an attitude. And we bought it for real. And they go out the back door. But the church is still here. The church is still here.
Yes, sir. We're here.
Let me get out of here. You gotta always be positive and powerful.
Yeah.
It costs nothing. You all cost nothing, but it creates much.
Yeah.
We talk about what love can do.
Yeah.
Love creates happiness in the home.
Yeah.
Love, folk, you all. Love fosters goodwill in a business.
Yeah.
Love, folk, you all.
Yeah.
Love rests with the weary.
Mm-hmm.
It lifts the weary.
Mm-hmm.
It's sunshine for the sad.
Yeah.
It cannot be bought.
Yeah.
Love cannot be begged.
Yeah.
Love cannot be bought.
Yeah.
Love cannot be stolen.
Yeah.
I'm done, y'all. May the Lord bless you.
Yeah.
Yeah. We got to have the right attitude.
Yeah.
Turn to the names of neighbor.
Neighbor.
You got to have a godly attitude. And a new conscious and control. You have a new purpose. And you will perform in a new way. You have a new song. And love will give you a new voice. You have a new spiritual eye. And your visions will be different. Love will give you a new hope. And you have new faith to realize it. Love will have you being a new creature. And you'll walk different. You'll walk circumspectly. Not as a foolish person, but as a wise one. Redeem in the time, in these evil days. And all you gotta do is look at the cross.
That's it.
And you know about love. Look what Jesus did. He died. God demonstrated his love toward us. And while we were yet sinners, he died. He died while you was drinking. He died while you was laying low. He died while you was smoking those bourbon cigarettes. He died. He died when you was casting your pearls, and then you was casting everything all around time. But that's why Jesus died, because you couldn't save yourself. Because if he didn't die, Sister Watson, we was on our way to hell without a savior. We was on our way to where the devil was, to be enveloped with him and all his demons and all his infamy. But thanks be to Jesus. I'm done, y'all. May the Lord bless you real good. Sister Larry, ain't God good?
Yeah.
Ain't God good?
Yes, man.
Told him, man.
Yes. Don't worry about the past.
Yes, sir.
Just go from where you are
yes,
right
sir.
Now. Because the past is the past.
It's the past.
You grew from the past.
Yeah.
You can look back at the past.
That's right.
The Bible says if you're a man,
yeah.
puts his hand to the ground, preach yeah. Reverend yeah. Island,
yeah.
and
don't look back.
Change your attitude.